Thank you very much, Haldor, for the invite from you and your team to be here. And it really is a privilege to be here at this institute in this city giving this talk. And you'll see why as I go through the talk, because actually Heidelberg has been very influential in the development of our understanding of madness and disorders like schizophrenia. So it really is the birthplace of many of the ideas that still influence how we diagnose these conditions today. I'm very happy to make the slides available, so you know nobody needs to take notes or anything like that. The title was From Madness to the Molecular Etiology. So I sort of started with a blank page, and I thought, I'm a clinician, I'm a psychiatrist, so I have a very clear idea in my head of what I mean by madness. But, you know, does everybody else have the same view of what madness is? So what I thought I would do, like, you know, the start of any good talk or the thinking process, I went to Google and I looked up the Oxford English Dictionary to find what the actual definition of madness was. So the definition of madness is the state of having a serious mental illness. But it also means extreme foolish behavior, and it also means a state of wild or chaotic activity. So even though in the modern world we have some sense of what serious mental illness is, or madness, we also as a society have wider views as to what madness is. So there's often a lot of confusion about a person's behavior if somebody does something odd or erratic or irrational. To me, that's odd and erratic and irrational. But is that an act of madness? I would say for him it's an act of madness. For him it's completely fine. But then you don't only just have the idea of madness as an act or a behavior, but people also use the term madness as an extreme emotion. So the idea of this man getting angry and getting mad exists in society. So we use madness and think of madness in those terms, and we really blur this sort of societal idea of what madness is from the sort of deeper idea of what I would understand as a working psychiatrist about actually what... Oh, yeah. Sorry, I'm just being advised to turn my phone off. So, you know, this isn't just a modern issue. I mean, we think of ourselves in many ways as being at the end of medicine, that we have a sort of a deep understanding of cancer and lots of disorders. But in my view, we're very much at the beginning with mental disorders. As I said, there's still very much a blur in the wider world and society as to what mental illness is compared to physical illnesses and how real mental illness is. So there's a lot of debate about this. In the way that maybe a century ago, if somebody collapsed in the street and was frothing at the mouth, people might have talked or thought about possession, whereas now they would say, well, look, that person is actually having a seizure, and that is epilepsy, and that person requires help. And people have society has a sort of a very definitive understanding, perhaps, of what that is, whereas mental illness is seen as much more uncertain. But this isn't new. I mean, this is something that society has grappled with for a long time. So this skull is at least 3,000 years old. And this is not the victim of some ritual sacrifice. This is somebody who went through a procedure called trepanation. So this person was operated on as such. And we know that because there's evidence of bone healing around the margins of that of the flap of skull that was taken out. So we can only speculate as to why that was, but my view is, and there are examples of this from a number of different cultures going back, you know, certainly to well before pre-Christian times, that this was an attempt to treat somebody who was having some form of a mental disorder that was identified by the community. So this may be one of the first treatments of schizophrenia or a psychotic disorder. And interestingly, if you go into the Middle Ages and late Middle Ages and up into the 19th century, you'll still see pictures with modern surgical implements doing these types of procedures 3,000-4,000 years later. So moving on really from ancient history into the early Middle Ages, this book, you may have to correct my pronunciation sometimes, but it's Der Hexenhammer. A very well-known book from 1486, and it was really part of the witch hysteria in the Middle Ages. And this Kramer categorized witches and their behavior. And when you look back at this book now, the sort of possession states and that they described and the behaviors that they described in witchcraft are very easily identifiable to a modern psychiatrist as being evidence of having a major mental illness. So we reach forward from sort of prehistory to the Middle Ages, and in many ways the underlying explanations as to the behavior that you might see in somebody who is mentally ill hasn't changed substantially. So when did that change happen? Well, the change happened really as you came into the start of the 19th century. And at the start of the 19th century, people became much more interested in applying the principles of natural science. So actually observing patients and doing experiments on patients and trying to get a better understanding of biological processes. So the idea of mental illness really became more clearly into focus. But mental illness was seen as a combination of, it was just widely, a wide category that would have included what we call seizure disorder today. It would have included learning disability. It would have included lots of different entities, and it was quite vague. And it was really Carl Sandsted in 1841, who was a German doctor, who he wrote a textbook that clarified understanding at the time about medical disorders, and he was the first one to use the term psychosis. And the reason he used it was, within the mental disorders, they identified what are called nervous disorders or neuroses, which they believed were due to problems of the nerves, which you could physically see manifest as anxiety, and other disorders where which they conceptualized as being brain disorders, and people behaved in an odd or strange way, and there were psychological manifestations of these brain disorders. And he used the term psychosis to refer specifically to that group of people. And that's really not changed too much into modern parlance. So what we mean by psychosis is disorders characterized by what we call impaired reality testing. So somebody who has a psychotic disorder may have a delusional belief. I give the example of a patient of mine who has four teeth. Four, they just have their incisors, and essentially she presented first to a dentist, but she presented to many, many dentists before that, because she said that one of the teeth in the back of her mouth was communicating to her and talking to her. So she went to a dentist and had it extracted, and then she went back and had more teeth extracted, until eventually she went to a dentist and she'd only four teeth left, and she explained to the dentist, maybe for the first time, why, her teeth may have been in bad condition, but why she was looking to have them removed. And the reason was because she wanted to stop the voice. But every time the tooth was moved, the voice in the tooth and the beliefs associated with that moved to the next tooth. And this has been, a long-term problem for her. So we see all different types of delusions, from people who believe that their partners are not showing fidelity, to people who have delusions of persecution or delusions of grandeur, or many, many or bizarre delusions about their thoughts being influenced by aliens or spaceships, and also beliefs that they're being possessed by outside forces. So, for example, the arrival of the movie The Matrix had a huge influence for us, because we ended up having lots of people who came in who said that they'd written The Matrix and the idea had been stolen from them, or had the belief that they were actually living in The Matrix. So, constantly, among my kind of clinical cases, I have people who believe that they're trapped in a world such as in The Matrix. And then we have people who experience hallucinations, the most common being auditory hallucinations and voices, but also people who have visual hallucinations, who see things or hear things or smell things. And these experiences are very real to the people. And what's interesting, actually, now you can do neuroimaging and you can actually look inside the functioning brain of somebody who's hallucinating. And what you actually see is activation of the temporal cortex, in the same way you see activation in somebody who's listening to real speech. So families often say to us, there is nobody talking, so why are they still talking about the voices? But in a way, for the person, the experience is very real. So just to move on from Carl Sandsted, Emil Kraepelin, who is a personal hero of mine in my field, he was the professor of psychiatry here in Heidelberg from 1890 to 1904, and he really revolutionized the field. He said that psychiatry should be seen like other natural sciences in medicine, that should be subject to observation and experimentation. So he collected huge amounts of data on the individuals that he saw and their families. And he was one of the first people to sort of formally realize that these disorders were more common in families. And he made a critical distinction. He said that, you know, these psychotic disorders aren't just one entity. He made a distinction between what he called dementia praecox, which later came to be known as schizophrenia, and manic depression. So he said there are some people who have an illness that's very much characterized by having all of these unusual beliefs or hallucinations, but this can be separated from another group of people whose illness is characterized by having episodes of mania where they're very high, or episodes of depression where they're very low. And it's really at those times that the psychotic symptoms hit them. And he established that firm division between these disorders, which has actually, you know, characterized our thinking to the present time. Bleuler then, who was a Swiss, worked around the same time, and he was the one who actually used the word schizophrenia for the first time. And he looked at similar patients to Kraepelin, but he said it's not actually about this psychosis. That's not the important feature of these patients. What's important in these people is that they have social deficits and an inability to socially interact with the world. And we now know that that's important. And so the third big figure then was Kurt Schneider, who was actually the head of Department of Medicine here in Heidelberg from the 1920s to the until the 1950s. And he profoundly influenced the thinking as well, because up until him, and he worked with Carl Jaspers and they shared quite similar ideas. But before him, people had said, well, what we need to do is understand the individual symptom. We need to understand why you think that you are being pursued by, this group of people, or why the police are trying to get you, or why you believe that you have the special power or ability, or why you're possessed by a devil. And rather than asking questions about the actual symptoms, he said that the symptoms themselves weren't important. You needed to look, the content was less important than the structure. He believed that different types of symptoms, such as hearing a voice speaking to you in the third person, or voices commenting on your activity, that identifying the types of symptoms would tell you about the underlying biology, and that this was more important than the content of the actual experience for the person. Now, out of the concepts, particularly of the latter three men, we ended up with this diagnostic criteria for schizophrenia. And Schneider and Kraepelin and Bleuler, if they were to read this, the schizophrenia criteria from 2013, they'd recognize themselves in there. They'd actually be, you know, very possibly depressed by the lack of progress, but they would actually see how heavily they had influenced thinking a full century later. So there would be nothing really in there that they didn't already know. I would make the comment, though, that here I'm just showing that in the century since these guys formalized their ideas, we have taken a small bite out of the concept of schizophrenia. So, you know, through modern medicine, we can identify about 100 different causes of psychosis. But together, these causes are quite rare. And most people who present with psychosis are going to have schizophrenia or a disorder like schizophrenia. One thing that is pretty interesting and maybe more important is that over the last 5 or 10 years, we started to identify that some people get an autoimmune disorder which attacks their own NMDA brain receptors, and they can present with psychosis. So there may be a subset of what we call schizophrenia that is actually an autoimmune disorder. And that's profoundly important, because that might require autoimmune therapy. So in my own institution, we've identified a number of individuals with this disorder, and the appropriate treatment for them then is immunotherapy to actually stop the attack on their NMDA receptors. So it is a clear biological form of psychosis that has a distinct treatment. So just moving on from there, Haldor said 1% of the population are affected. So, you know, I come from a country of 4 million people, and this is our largest stadium, which holds about 80,000 people. So you can actually fill you can fill the stadium with people in Ireland who have psychosis. And it's not because psychosis is particularly common in Ireland, it's just, you know, it's a common problem. And it's a problem that is currently diagnosed based on clinical acumen rather than on biology. So, you know, if you take the stadium as a psychiatrist, I will look at the clinical symptoms and I'll be able to say that you meet the criteria for schizophrenia, so really this is the part of the stadium that you sit in. Or that you meet the criteria for bipolar disorder, so this is the part of the stadium that you fit in. And that's really just going back to the work of Emil Kraepelin from here. And what's actually happened in the 1940s is this new box was created to allow for the fact that some people don't sit easily between these two boxes and actually have symptoms that combine both. And also just to mention that there are other kind of rarer types of psychosis that we identify. I think what's important is that the lines that we draw are based on clinical observation of symptoms and course of illness rather than biology. And the outer bounds of the stadium are blurred, because we would say that 1 to 2%, about 2% of the population experience full-blown psychosis, but actually at least 5% of the population at some time have had the experience or have the experience of hearing voices. So there is some blurring of the boundary of the disorders that we talk about into the more general population. And we don't understand the biology of that either. So what do we know about schizophrenia? What have we learned that would surprise Kraepelin and Bleuler and Schneider? Well, we know that there's an increased family history of schizophrenia in people who are affected. We also know that people with schizophrenia are more likely to have older fathers. So having an older father substantially increases your risk. We know that through these things, we know that there's an increased rate of prenatal health problems. So maternal infection or maternal malnutrition, perinatal complications. We see evidence that people who go on to develop schizophrenia have delayed walking and talking, that they're more likely to have a history of childhood trauma. So this evidence suggests that schizophrenia, although it doesn't manifest until you're in your 20s, typically, but it seems to be some type of neurodevelopmental process. We also know that history of cannabis use, particularly in people who start cannabis young, is associated with increased risk. So a colleague of mine called Stan Zammit in the UK has done a lot of work on epidemiological data sets and been able to show that the earlier you smoke cannabis and the heavier you smoke cannabis, the more your risk is increased. But the question is whether this is cannabis as a cause of psychosis or cannabis just triggering an innate predisposition to psychosis, we're not yet sure. We also know that risk of social stress or marginalization in populations is important on the developing brain. So it's not just all about genetics. We know that some people, because of the way societies function, people can become stressed and that can contribute to risk as well. And we know that the longer your psychosis is untreated, the worse the prognosis. So this has been a huge problem. So typically what we see in the clinic is that a person might be in college, doing fine, and then not doing so fine in college, struggling with their grades, not really meeting their friends as much, maybe starting to have some unusual or odd ideas. Then they might stop socializing. They may end up going home and spending a lot of time by themselves or in their family home. And then they stop interacting as much with their family as they did. And they may end up just eating their meals alone in the bedroom and locking the bedroom door. And often it's at that point that we get involved or are called in. But that the process from the very start of the symptoms to that point can take several years. So we often find that when we first have contact with people, they've had an insidious onset gradually developing over a couple of years, and that's associated with a worse prognosis. Now, sometimes we do see people who have a much quicker prognosis and develop symptoms over the course of days or weeks, but more typically, it's this insidious type of prognosis. As I said, the onset is typically in the early 20s. About 20% have only one episode, but 50% have recurrent episodes and 30% sort of have a continuous, unremittent illness. And this is with current therapies. So there are effective treatments for some symptoms, particularly the psychosis that I spoke about, the delusions and the hallucinations. We can treat those symptoms using antipsychotic medication, and also there are psychological approaches that are helpful as well. But the drugs that we use are based on a dopamine hypothesis of schizophrenia that was discovered more or less by accident in the 1950s. So the treatments are based on serendipity, the discovery that these drugs help without really an understanding of why they help. And there haven't really been any substantial drug breakthroughs since the 1950s. And we also know that certain symptoms, the motivational problems, concentration problems, and memory problems, which can really impair somebody's ability to function, they don't really get touched by the drugs. But some, as I said, some psychological approaches can help. And there's significant health consequences. And to my mind, this is a sort of a staggering statistic, which is that in the Western world, and this is in Sweden, presumably Germany, but I'm not sure, certainly in the UK and in the US, having schizophrenia reduces your life expectancy by 20 years. So some of that is due to an increased rate of schizophrenia, but or increased rate of suicide, but actually a lot of it is due to sort of comorbid problems, not looking after themselves, and putting, you know, people putting themselves in risk, in a position of risk, because they're socially marginalized individuals. But what's happened is this gap, the gap between the normal life expectancy and life expectancy in this population is actually growing. So as the life expectancy from the 80s and 90s has improved for the general population, these guys have stuck. So it's gone from a gap of 13 years to 20 years. And this is despite treatment. So where do I come in, or what's my sort of interest in all this? As I said at the start, I'm a clinician and a psychiatrist, so I really wanted a way, when I studied in college, I was fascinated by just how little we knew about these disorders, and I got into this field of medicine and really empathized with the patients and liked working with the people, but I felt as if I was one of these 19th century clinicians, because we really didn't know much about the biology of what's going on at all, and really trying to understand that better has been the driving force for my career to date. So we know that schizophrenia is substantially heritable, and we know that having a first degree relative with schizophrenia increases your risk ninefold. But we also know that there seems to be genetic overlap in families between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, from work by Paul Lichtenstein and Christine Hulsman at the Karolinska. And we know that the heritability that we're talking about here is genetic effects. So this is for schizophrenia. It's genetic effects that are unique to schizophrenia. There's genetic effects that are common between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. There's shared environmental effects, so that might be effects within families, but they're actually relatively small. So the influence of your family can be very important on how you live with the disorder, but it's not really that important on whether you're going to get the disorder or not. And we know then that there's non-shared environmental effects. So why do genetics? So for me, the idea or the hope was that identifying genes would help us to understand the biology of the disorder better, and that this may improve our ability to diagnose things, that we might identify new links between different diseases, that we might find novel treatment targets and actually develop personalized medicine for patients, but also for prevention strategies, so that people, you know, that we could identify people who might be at higher risk of developing schizophrenia and try and help them not use cannabis, or to try and manage psychological distress in a way that they wouldn't actually go on and develop the full disorder. So what... Before I came into the field, around 1990, this paper was published in The Lancet by David Sinclair and colleagues from Aberdeen and from Edinburgh at the time. And what they found in the Scottish population, they were looking, doing cytogenetic studies. So they were looking for deletions or duplications of chromosomes or translocations of chromosomes, and they were looking in populations of troubled kids. It was very it wasn't very clear. It was some kids with learning disability, but they identified a boy who had conduct disorder, conduct problems, behavioral problems. And they found then that in his family, he had a huge extended family of people who had increased risk of schizophrenia and other disorders, but particularly schizophrenia. And they found that within the family, the people who were affected by the disorders, and as I said, it's not just schizophrenia. Schizophrenia are just the people with the full black dots. What they found was that these people carried a translocation that impaired, that interrupted the function of a gene, and they called the gene disrupted in schizophrenia 1, disc 1. So this was of huge interest to the field, and they've done a lot of work on this pedigree and extended it since, and there's very strong evidence that disc 1 is, this translocation disrupting disc 1 is important as a risk factor in this population. So there's been a huge lot of biology done to try and understand the function of disc 1. Now when I came into the field, the hope was that we would find lots and lots of disc 1s.
What we knew about was another condition called velocardofacial syndrome, which is another chromosomal deletion syndrome that actually also increased risk of schizophrenia or psychosis 20 or 30 fold. But that was all we had. And the criticism was that these were little islands within, you know, the stream of people with psychosis. And they were of peculiar interest to that family or to a few people, but they couldn't be generalized to teach us about what was going on with most people. So there was a real, there was a community that studied disc one, and then there was a wider schizophrenia research community that said, well, it's not really relevant to everybody else. So I started in the field, and when we, you know, we started collecting samples and putting together a psychosis collection in Ireland. At this stage, we've actually recruited about 5% of all of the patients in Ireland. So we've recruited quite large numbers of people. But this is what my early research career more or less felt like, searching for a needle in a haystack. Because really, we didn't have the genetic tools to delve into the genome. We didn't have enough samples if the effects were going to be small. And we were sort of scrambling around saying, well, this jump, you know, we can, for my PhD, I looked at a family of 6 or 7 genes that I thought might be interesting, looked at a certain number of markers across the genes, didn't really find a huge amount, but it was kind of the best you could do at the time. So it was quite dispiriting for the first 5 or 6 years, because you felt that you were just looking for a needle in the haystack. And I was telling Adam earlier on, what actually happened was technology changed. And obviously there was the Human Genome Project with publication of the Human Sequence. There was the HapMap project, which looked at the structure of common genetic variation in the genome. And out of these arose better technology. So the technology to actually allow you to comprehensively start to study the genome. So this initially for us meant doing studies of common genetic variation, but actually on a global scale. So looking at 1 million markers across the genome to look for common variants that might contribute to the disorder, but also a growing, dawning realization that we're going to have to look in big numbers of samples. But it allowed us to sort of look at one category of variation properly for the first time. So I compared this to sort of saying, well, here we were hunting for a needle in a haystack, and suddenly we found a magnet. We were handed a magnet, and it was a game changer for us because we could start to try and find needles. So what sort of needles could we look for? So this is from a colleague called Mark McCarthy, who's done a lot of work in diabetes. And really what we're showing here is that you're going to have, in the human population, you're going to have common variants that are present in about 10% of people, uncommon ones, rare ones, and then very rare ones, which might be even unique to a single individual. And the effects of these on risk of a disorder are going to go from very low to modest to intermediate to very high. So you end up having sort of these different search spaces in genetics that you can look in. So what we were trying to do very early on, when we were doing linkage studies and I was doing association studies at the sort of 2000 to 2004, 2005, was we were hoping we'd stumble along a very large effect in the population that contributed to risk in lots and lots of people. So that would be a little bit like in Alzheimer's disease, we know about APOE. The APOE alleles as being risk factors for Alzheimer's disease that have a big effect on risk. But actually, we now know that in common diseases, this is very rare. So we really didn't find anything very much there. But we could see that in other fields, people were starting to be able to find smaller effects by doing these GWAS studies. So we were able to start to look do these GWAS studies and start to try and find smaller genetic effects. Now, and a really good example for us was that we collaborated with people, particularly Mark Daly, who's at the Broad Institute at MIT, and they'd been having great success with Crohn's disease. And we had a lot of discussion with them because they'd gone from sort of pretty much down here where we were to suddenly up here around 2007 because they'd started putting samples together. So as a group, we sat down, there were 6 of us originally, and we said we need to put together a consortium to look for the genetics of schizophrenia. And there was 2 consortiums. One was mostly based in Ireland, UK. There was some people from Portugal and the US. And then there was another consortium that was Germany, Iceland, and others. And so 2 consortia ended up sort of springing up at the same time. And the hope was that through numbers that we might find the same things in schizophrenia that we would find in other disorders. We were told that, this was nonsense because we didn't even know what the disease was. How are we going to find anything? And our response was, well, we don't know what it is, but we do know that whatever it is, it's very heritable. And that's probably the best place to start in genetics. So what did we hope that we might find? I mean, it's in a way, it's not just about collecting numbers of loci. It's actually about biological understanding. So one of the things, this is a very nice review by David Altshuler and colleagues from just earlier this year. What you would hope to find, and this is just sort of proof of principle from different disorders like hyperlipidemia, type 2 diabetes, rheumatoid, psoriasis, etc., is that among the variants that you find are things that are very important for targeting for drugs. So generally, there's a lot of discussion about how useful GWAS studies have been, but the reality is that we know from proof of principles from drugs that we already have that we would have identified these mechanisms through GWAS studies. It's too early to say, really, for most of medicine, whether we'll develop new drugs because the pipeline is so long, but we know that some of the drugs that we do have would have been discovered using this approach. So where did we get to with schizophrenia? So one thing that we stumbled upon very quickly, well, there was this paper by a colleague of mine called Jonathan Sabat, and they found evidence using a different type of array that very small deletions and duplications that you couldn't see under a microscope were more common in the human population than we'd known before about 2006. We'd assumed that you could see them, you know, using cytogenetic approaches, that there were big ones, but we just didn't know that there were little ones, and there's actually quite a lot of little ones. And he found some evidence to suggest that the little ones might be associated with schizophrenia. So we had our SNP data, million markers across the genome, and we realized that using that data, we could find runs of SNPs where there was extra copies or a lack of a copy, and that from that we could infer whether there were duplications or deletions. And we could look at a sort of a scale of about 100 kilobases. And doing that in 2008, we published our first paper, which was in Nature, which was nice. And this identified a couple of chromosomal deletions that were associated with schizophrenia. And these were published back-to-back by the work from the other consortium, which had found the same one. So we were able to say that DISC or the 22q deletion syndrome that had been known wasn't unique. There was certainly more of these out there to be found. And then more recently, you know, what's tended to happen is these are quite large events that implicate lots and lots of genes. But more recently in 2011, again with Jonathan Sabat and others, I was involved in a study where we identified a duplication in a gene called Viper2. So you have got down to a single gene, which is a potential target for treatment in this group of patients who carry it. So this information could be quite useful. Now, so we went from a situation where in the population we had these one or two isolated events to this, which is today. And we now know of quite a few of these, what we maybe would describe as genomic disorders that are within the schizophrenia population. So how important is that? Pretty important. About 5% of our patients have them, which is, you know, significant given that we see lots of patients. And we know that some of our patients, and this is just from work from my group in the sample that we look at, that some people have fairly, you know, very well recognized syndromes and we just weren't looking for them. So there are people with 22q11 deletion syndrome, we see people with Williams syndrome, and we see people with Joubert syndrome within the schizophrenia population. So my view is that at least some of the patients that we have who have physical health problems, it may be because they've actually undiagnosed known genetic syndromes. So that's kind of important. But also out of the 1q21 deletion work, we found that some of these deletions are new syndromes. So this was unheard of before 2008, and now this is a sort of a defined syndrome that is known that can be looked for. And one of the reason I put up this slide is what's important is that any of the CNVs are the structural variants that we found that are important in schizophrenia are also important in other developmental disorders. So this is a deletion that's relevant to schizophrenia, but also half of the patients have microcephaly, many of them have mild learning disability, many of them have autism and other features as well. So people who carry these syndromes don't just have schizophrenia as an outcome, they have other neurodevelopmental outcomes potentially. So that really got us into this search space here, which was kind of looking at low frequency variants with some intermediate penetrance. But obviously it was going to be very hard to find things that were much rarer or more unique, because even though, you know, we had samples of 3,000 people, the kind of things we were finding were present in 10 cases and, you know, no controls. So I've just finished work on we found another one in duplication that affects a particular gene that actually interacts with disc one, which started the whole story, which is kind of nicely circular. But we've had to study, you know, I've data on 150,000 people to actually try and clarify the risk associated with that. So it's difficult because these are quite rare. So what then about, you know, so just to point out that this is very different from other common disorders. So the diabetes and Crohn's disease and the examples I gave there, they don't find these types of CNVs as being associated with the disorder. So the question was, well, would we be able to find the sort of common effects that they did? So this was Stefan Ripke, who's a colleague of mine, who actually ran the analysis for this. Once we'd done the International Schizophrenia Consortium, we realized we didn't have enough numbers, so we got all the consortia on board, and when we had our first consortium with 3,000 cases, we published a GWAS, and by looking at other GWAS data from other sources, we were able to cross-study to say that we had a peak here that met this line of significance. So what you're looking at here is 1 million markers across the genome. We describe this as a Manhattan plot, though, to be honest, this doesn't look much like Manhattan. And because of the amount of tests you're doing, this is the bar for statistical significance. So it's 10 to the minus 8, 5 times 10 to the minus 8, to correct for the amount of tests that you're doing. So we had really one that snuck over the bar in 2009 in our first paper from the International Schizophrenia Consortium. What we did next was put all the consortia data together, and we got like about 9,000 cases and published this in Nature Genetics in 2011. And we had 5 loci new, and you can see that now there was a couple of the other loci that had been reported elsewhere had sort of come to the fore. Doesn't look much like Manhattan, but you're starting to say that maybe this approach might work. There was a lot of criticism in our field saying, still, it's a waste of time. You've looked at 9 or 10,000 cases and you don't really find very much. And we said, well, actually, if you take Crohn's disease, diabetes, obesity, cancer, they've only really got successful where they've had even more numbers. And the response to that was, you know, you're just wasting money at this stage. You've got 4 or 5. It is different. And we were sort of saying, no, it's not. So the reality is, it's not different. So we've just completed the latest phase of this consortia very recently. We're actually just writing the paper at the moment. And this is what we see now. And that is Manhattan. So we've gone by increasing the number of cases up to 38,000 and increasing the number of controls, we identify 128 independent SNPs across the genome, and these fall into 108 distinct loci. So we've only really had this information since the finalized data, since sort of August, September, and we're working on the paper. So there's still a lot of work to be done to actually understand what all of these different effects mean. But I'll give you some sort of inkling as to where we're getting with that. But it's starting to look more like Manhattan and more like other disorders. So really what we found essentially was that despite the criticism, once we started to ramp up our numbers in the same way that other fields had done, we found the same sort of pattern of discovery as Crohn's disease. So as of now, we're still in the process of recruiting more samples to sort of expand this out, because obviously the more loci that we have identified, the more information for us from a research point of view. So schizophrenia behaves very much like other complex disorders, and that was sort of reassuring. The second thing is that we found that common but small genetic effects explain about 23-25% of the variance in schizophrenia risk. So based on the information that we have, and this is work by Naomi Ray from Australia, we were able to say that the small genetic effects account for about 25% of the susceptibility to the disorder. Third thing that we're able to say, which is pretty interesting, is that having known within families that there was overlap between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, we're able to use the GWAS data to actually look at that in more detail. So this was a method developed by Naomi Ray and Peter Fisher and Sean Purcell, which we applied to the International Schizophrenia data set. And what I'm showing in this plot, which you can't see very clearly, but essentially what we did was we said, we only have a couple of hits in the data set, but we have a very punitive correction of 10 to the minus 8 for this data set. So what if we take the top 10% of all the SNPs in the data, of all the markers, why don't we see if that can predict risk in another schizophrenia data set? Because if it can, it means there's true signal within that information. So then we did that and we found that it could. So it was that we were able to predict into this other data set. This one we weren't, but this was an Afro-American population and the genetic structure may have been different. But we were able to predict into another data set the same thing. And then we said, well, we know there's an overlap with bipolar. So if we take that 10% of markers into a bipolar data set, will we be able to make, you know, will it predict risk in bipolar? And it did. And we were able to do that in two different bipolar data sets. And then we said, well, look, is this just some general weird artifact thing? So what about if we look at a lot of other diseases like coronary artery disease, Crohn's disease, hypertension, rheumatoid, and diabetes? And what we actually found is essentially flat. So the SNPs that contribute to the data here aren't telling you anything about risk here. So we then said, okay, well, what if we increase the cutoff to 20%? Are we still getting extra information? And we found that when we went to 20, 30, 40, 50%, we were still capturing more information. There was obviously lots and lots of noise, but we were still adding to the model. So it suggested that there's probably quite a lot of risk variance involved. So that really provided nice evidence that for overlap between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. And then what we decided to do, and this was work that was led by Naomi Ray, who I mentioned before, was we decided to look across disorders. So here we have the evidence of heritability from SNP data in ADHD, bipolar, schizophrenia, major depression, and autism. And what we found was that there's significant evidence of overlapping risk between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, but also between schizophrenia and major depression, and also between schizophrenia and autism. So this is evidence that actually underneath, you know, we conceptualize these disorders as being very different, but some of the genetic architecture is the same. So what are the SNPs doing? Are they just randomly scattered through the genome? One would hope that they focus in regulatory regions and that they're going to map to regions of functionality. So Ole Andersen, a colleague of mine in Norway, has been looking at this, and essentially this is the null distribution here, and this plot is for schizophrenia. This is the null distribution, and what he finds is that if you look at just non-exonics, you know, SNPs that aren't in functional regions, they follow the null distribution. Whereas if you divide SNPs into different classes of effect, looking at SNPs that are likely to be regulatory or more highly functional, you see that this deviation from the null distribution. So what that means is you're getting enrichment when we look at the SNPs that are near the top of our, you know, near the higher part of the skyline in Manhattan. What we're actually finding is that the SNPs there are much more likely to be functional, which suggests they're likely to be relevant to the disease. We've also just very recently started to look at the effects of the genes and SNPs on gene function, and we found evidence for enrichment in particular tissues. And what we found is, you know, reassuringly, we find that the functionality of the SNPs is particularly in nervous system, which is, you know, very reassuring, but also in the immune system. So there's a growing realization that immune function may be important to schizophrenia etiology. So what else? I mean, I've talked sort of big picture, but I haven't really talked about genes at all yet, or particular genes. So we have identified specific risk genes for schizophrenia. So the largest effect that we see, which is actually the same true for a lot of common disorders, is at the major histocompatibility complex region. And so we've seen this consistently from the start of doing the GWAS. Now this is problematic. I don't really expect you to be able to see the details of this figure. All it is really to point out is that this line is the line of significance, and all of these little dots here represent genes across a region. And what you can really see is at the major histocompatibility complex region, because there's significant linkage disequilibrium between markers, markers are highly intercorrelated, we see huge numbers of SNPs that exceed the level of significance here. So it's a very difficult region to map and to understand what the biology of this is going to be about. So actually I've an article just in the current issue of Biological Psychiatry where I've just reviewed schizophrenia and the MHC, so if anyone's interested, that's kind of easy to follow up. One thing that was pretty reassuring is that one of the other top hits was for the dopamine D2 receptor, and the SNPs here just correlate right over the gene. And that's important because the D2 receptor is the gene, is the receptor that current drugs act on. So again, it's kind of proof of principle that we're sort of onto the right thing. The other sort of prevailing hypothesis in schizophrenia is that glutamate dysfunction is important and NMDA dysfunction is particularly important. That's been more difficult to target from a sort of pharmacological point of view, but reassuringly, we find three of the glutamatergic genes has been implicated in our analysis. So what's kind of, there's obviously a lot more that's novel because I'm talking about, 108 different regions and I'm just cherry picking particular stories, if you like, at the moment. But one other thing that's been very important and interesting and unexpected is the effect of calcium channel genes. So three of the strongest hits we find in schizophrenia are in calcium channel genes. And that's important because there's lots of different ways of targeting calcium channel genes from a pharmacological point of view. And that really hasn't been a strategy that's been attempted in schizophrenia to date. So what else is new? I had said with the copy number variants, the CNVs, that we found overlap between schizophrenia and intellectual disability and autism. And we find very much the same thing. So just observing the list of loci, we find that three of the loci that are hit are known autism, are known autism genes. And also we identify quite a number of different genes that have been that are known from intellectual disability. So what's kind of interesting here is we have a picture where severe mutations which are rare in the population in these genes can cause autism or intellectual disability, but we're finding much more subtle effects in the same genes happening in schizophrenia. So what it suggests is that the genes and the function of these genes is going to be very important across a range of neurodevelopmental disorders. And then we sort of did a formal analysis just to see if there was significant overlap between genes in schizophrenia in these intervals, the 108 intervals, and genes that are known to have de novo mutations in severe intellectual disability, and there is a very significant overlap between the two. So in many ways, the biology of what's known about often Mendelian severe mental disorders is actually going to be potentially quite useful in helping us understand some of the biology that's underlying schizophrenia. So I've spoken a bit about single genes, but obviously when you have 108 different genes, rather than looking at 108 independent stories, what you want to start doing is putting the information together into sort of a meaningful molecular pathway or to understand it in a better way in that sense. So one thing that we've done in my group, before the latest freeze of the PGC2, where we had the big Manhattan plots, where we only had, at the point where we only had a few of these, we sort of decided to delve into the area here where you just have nominally significant SNPs, and just to see, could you do a hypothesis-free analysis of pathways and just see where do these map in KEG pathways? So you take all the KEG pathways and just see, is there enrichment of these SNPs in any particular KEG pathways? And what we found was that the pathways implicated were in neuronal cell adhesion and membrane scaffolding as being particularly important at the time. That was about 2008 or 2009 or 2010. And actually there's been two or three different approaches to tackling the same problem in the data set at this point in time, which have kind of converged really on neuronal cell adhesion and signaling as being important and see many of the same, suggesting that the pathway might be important. So as we have more loci, it allows you to try and identify patterns using molecular, pathway approaches for more of the data, because, as you get up into Manhattan and have lots and lots of signal up here, you're reducing the amounts of false positives in here, and it's a less noisy data set to work on, which is good. But what you can also do is look sort of vertically. So this is the TCF4 gene, which is known to be implicated in intellectual disability. But you can take this gene, and you can actually see, well, what's the effect of this gene? And it's known to have quite an important regulatory effect on different signaling pathways. So you can kind of go broadly and identify pathways by using the SNP information or information from the CNVs across many CNVs, but there are specific genes that may be particularly important because they regulate other parts of the system, and identifying them is likely to be valuable. So the way I sort of conceptualize it is that there's a schizophrenia network. There's part of the network overlaps with autism, part of it overlaps with bipolar disorder, and within the network there are these like distinct disease entities. So when Bleuler, who originally used the term schizophrenia, he didn't really talk about schizophrenia. He talked about the group of schizophrenias. He saw it as a group of different disorders represented by by a syndrome. And I kind of see things, and a lot of people start to see things in the same way too. So there might be individual diseases that occur within this network, that some of which we know already. And then there might be particular mechanisms where you have specific genes or genetic effects that are particularly important within the network. And different aspects of the network may determine what your actual biological outcome is, whether it's that you develop autism, whether you develop bipolar disorder, or whether you develop schizophrenia in the middle. So I think we're starting to see things much more in terms of network medicine and mapping the common variant information we have with rare variant information as well. So there's always the question then, when I started, I was interested in diagnostics. So, can we use this information in a diagnostically helpful way? I just back up and I would say, we know that's likely to be true for some of these people. We doesn't really impact treatment yet, but we do know that if you carry one of these big mutations, it's going to increase your risk of having schizophrenia 5 to 10-fold. It's going to increase your risk of having some neurodevelopmental problem up to 30 or 40-fold, up to sort of 30 or 40% or more. And so that information can be very important within families. So there are isolated examples where diagnostic information, the genetic findings may be important, but they're isolated. I think in the main, the question for us is, out of Manhattan, can we use that information for useful risk prediction? And there's companies being set up already that have offered testing for schizophrenia risk based on the information. And that's obviously, we know what's happened with 23andMe very recently with the FDA, that they've had concerns about the quality of their data, the false positives and the false negatives in the information that they give. So with the information we have right now in schizophrenia, what's risk prediction like? Well, we can look at risk profile scores based on the information that we have for these alleles. And we have population samples available from Sweden and from Denmark. And we can start to run analyses and look at risk prediction. So what you see here is deciles. So these are the people here who carry, so these people down here carry, are the people in the bottom 10% of carriers of risk alleles. And these are the people here who are in the top 10%. So in the population, if we've 108 risk alleles, some people are going to have hardly any, and some people are going to have lots. So what we can see here is that if you have hardly any, even though you're a patient, your risk of schizophrenia, the odds ratio is going to be relatively small. If you have, as the number of risk alleles that you have increases, the odds ratio increases. Up to the point that if you're in the top 10%, you have an odds ratio, a risk of getting schizophrenia of somewhere between 6 and 8%. So it's a 6 or 7, in and around a 7-fold increased risk of schizophrenia, which is a lot. But I think the really critical thing here is that the area under the curve is poor from a predictive point of view, and that actually 33% of controls fall into this box as well. So having started doing schizophrenia research and actually thinking this is a very stigmatized field, and one thing I could be doing is increasing stigma by sort of saying you have a genetic disorder that makes you different, the message for my patients has actually been incredibly reassuring, which is essentially that you may have schizophrenia, but there's a lot, most of the people out there, everybody out there has some schizophrenia risk genes, and actually So there's nothing very different about you. You've developed the disorder through a very, through a confluence of different factors. But we as a population all share some schizophrenia genes. And there's many people walking around who, of the ones that we know so far, carry very many of these common risk variants but just don't get schizophrenia. So just going to coming to the end, I've talked about GWAS a little bit and common variation, but I haven't talked about genome sequencing and looking for very rare genetic variants. Because that's hard, there's about three or four studies published. I was working just to complete a paper we have on about 50 exomes, so exome sequencing of 50 or 60 individuals and their parents, where we've identified some rare mutations that are interesting, and we know of two or three other big data sets that are out there. But the data really isn't at a point where there's a clear convergence in the rare variant work. And I think it's because many genes are likely to be in schizophrenia, involved in schizophrenia, I think it's going to be very challenging to identify, looking at very rare mutations that happen, because these happen in people's genomes anyway, which are going to be the ones that are important and which won't be. But I do think that we will be able to make progress in that regard, because I think we're going to be able to reduce the search space a lot, because we're going to say, what we're looking for is genes that impact this functional pathway, and looking to see across studies, is that pathway coming up again and again, and are genes in that pathway coming up again and again? And I think that'll inform us as to which are the key genes to study from a molecular biology point of view. Because what you want really is a mutation in a base that changes the structure of the protein that has a big effect on risk, because that's really easy, much easier to study biologically than a common variant that only has a very, very tiny individual effect on risk. So I think these things are out there, and I think there is already some evidence that of convergence on pathways, but it's unpublished yet. So the future directions, as I really see them, are that we have this stadium full of people, a very common problem. And there's been described as a drug deadlock because of the difficulties in generating new drugs. And one of the societal issues about that drug deadlock is that a lot of the drug companies have decided that it's just too hard to find psychiatric drugs. So they've abandoned, there was a move away from looking from neuroscience and from trying to find these drugs. But the reality actually is that for the size of the problem, there was relatively small money spent by drug companies in this field compared to cardiovascular disease or compared to cancer. So the level of investment has been relatively small to date. And that's really, to my mind, the drug deadlock. There's been a lot of hand-wringing about, how hard it is to find drugs in this research area. But my view, it's just about investment. There hasn't been the same level of investment as there's been in other areas. So my hope is that as we start to put the gene findings together and identify specific pathways, we can use this pathway information in a number of different ways. We'll find key components of the pathway, and we're already doing this to do cellular work, in vivo work, to understand the mechanisms involved and just to see whether we can target them reverse them using therapeutics. So this is starting very much to happen as people start to target particular drugs. It's happening in my lab and it's happening in lots of different labs. And one of the things that's actually advantageous for us, just as a sort of aside, is that a lot of the etiology is likely to involve secondary signaling mechanisms. And there's been a huge amount of investment in targeting these mechanisms of sort of protein kinase signaling in cancer. So there's probably, in my view, lots and lots of cancer drugs that weren't very effective sitting on shelves that may be very useful to us. So, for example, a mechanism that we have a huge interest in, we were wondering how would we go about starting to target this mechanism, and we realized that two different drug companies had cancer trials of inhibitors that act on this mechanism already. And talking to other colleagues, that's what they find. You find something and you say, oh my God, I'm starting down a whole new route again. But you actually find that because there's been so much investment in these systems in cancer, you may be able to get a bit of a head start. There may be some biologically useful information already there. The second thing is that we can actually study the people. And one of the problems with the mouse models and we've had so far is the models very much are looking at behavior that looks like somebody who has schizophrenia. So you don't have a mouse that hears a voice, but you might have a mouse that's socially isolated and you try and equate the two. Whereas if we are able to identify humans with specific mutations, we can model those specific mutations directly in mice. And that's a much more direct animal model. And similarly, then, we can do lots of electrophysiological studies, which we do in my lab in quite a large way, looking at electrophysiology or neurocognitive performance. And we can actually parallel study the human individual who's got schizophrenia, and many of the same tests can be done in the mouse that's got the same mutation. So we have maybe much more coherent models. And the other thing that we can obviously use and are starting to use are things like iPS technology. So we'll harvest cells from fibroblasts from patients who have interesting genes and start to do work on these cells, derive neurons or specific neuronal classes and start to study the neurons directly. So Fred Gage published the first paper on that about 2 years ago in Nature, but you know there's quite a lot of people working in that area. And the hope then is that this information will break the dreaded drug deadlock and allow us to treat the patient population more successfully. But it might mean much more personalized medicine in that we might say that this person has a specific disc 1 related pathology and needs that particularly targeted. And so they're kind of different from other people who have the disorder. But it also probably challenges some of our concepts about the disorders, because it might be that within a family, you have a person who has schizophrenia, you have a person with intellectual disability, and a person with seizure disorder. And we see families like that out there a lot. And they all, you know, leave the house to go to their doctor, and they all head in different directions. You know, the kid goes to a pediatrician, the other guy goes to a neurologist, and one of them comes to me for treatment of the disorder. But actually, if the underlying biology and mechanism of treatment is the same, we really need a new field in the future in medicine to be more specifically treating the underlying biology, rather than treating what are sort of, in one way, stale old textbooks that created these divisions in the first place. So I can't thank all of my international collaborators, so I'll just put up a picture of most of them. And it's been a very, really a privilege to work in this field because it's a really vibrant, really enthusiastic, supportive community of scientists around the world. And we share data. We, you know, if we have hypotheses, we're happy to sort of throw them out to somebody else to test them in their data set and knock them on the head if they're rubbish so we can move on to something that might be genuinely true. I think we've all spent too much time as a field searching for needles in haystacks, and we got tired of that. So as a group, I think we are keen to use as many magnets as we can to pull out needles, as I said. So I'd like to really just thank you for your attention and just ask if anyone's any questions.
So you mentioned that, is this working? Yeah. That there may be many loci involved in these disorders, and perhaps the same with autism. And I'm just wondering whether, could it be that, so you have these different alleles throughout the population, and potentially some of these alleles could be positively being selected in combination with certain other alleles, but then when you get a certain mix, you get a deleterious effect like this. I mean, do you think any of these variants may be actually advantageous under certain conditions or in certain genotypes?
I do. I think we're just programmed to look for risk effects rather than protective effects. So one of the things that's emerged very recently, like literally only a few weeks ago, is that I spoke about this 22q11 deletion syndrome, which it's actually the commonest chromosomal deletion in the human genome, and it's associated with learning disability, but about 20 or 30 fold increased risk of psychosis. But colleagues in Cardiff, and we were involved in this, they found that the reciprocal duplication at that region is associated with reduced schizophrenia risk. So for some of these known CNVs that have large effects, the reciprocal event is protective. And I think, for fairly large effects, it's easy to conceptualize and model that. But when you look at very many small effects, it becomes much more difficult. But I think it's a really good point, because if we start building networks that are entirely based on risk, we're going to really miss a trick. So we should look at protective networks and resilience as well.
Regarding these 109 risk genes that you presented here in your talk, in how many of those the SNP actually resides within the coding region of this so-called risk gene and how many it's further apart than, let's say, 10 kb from the gene?
Yeah, that's actually that's a really good question. And I actually had a slide which isn't on this that actually directly, I have a pie chart that shows that. So the answer to that is that it's very similar to what you find in other disorders like type 2 diabetes, Crohn's disease. When you look across these disorders, a certain percentage of them are just in gene deserts. So 10 or 15%, I think, are in gene deserts. So it's very difficult. So some of these loci, it's just going to be very difficult to establish what's going on at all. Whereas about 30, I think around 30% of them implicate single genes. So are within, mapped to the coding regions of genes. And then about 20 or 25%, it's difficult to distinguish between a couple of different loci. So for example, you might have a gene that, you might have a SNP that there's a number of different SNPs and it's unclear whether it's gene A or gene B. Or in the case of the MHC, it could be any one of 20 or 30 genes. So the answer then, I guess, is that, quite a substantial proportion of them do map to particular regions. Now, that said, the amount of them that we can directly implicate in function, so that they actually change a bit, you know, our protein changing, that's not what you find in common genetic disorders at all. So that would be very relatively rare across disorders and is very rare in schizophrenia too. But you find that a percentage of the ones that are known to hit the exome, about 20%, 25%, are clearly, you know, we can start to identify regulatory functions for them at this point. And they would be clearly the ones we're going to target first.
Okay. And can you correlate these genes that have been predicted or found by GWAS to your latest results from the exome sequencing approaches? Is there a sort of a correlation to draw?
Yeah, I mean, so there's probably just not enough exome data published. So there's about three exome studies published, and we have one in press, but it's under review, and it's like 50 trios. There's a larger Swedish one and there's a UK one that are under review as well that have more. But there's just insufficient data. So for example, in our study, we identified 5 nonsense mutations that look to be pathological. They were all in cases. We didn't find any similar nonsense mutations in control populations. But just the numbers are so small. And I think, you know, what you'd want to do is maybe try and see, are they on the list of 108? But I think the reality is that we're going to continue to do GWAS, and the 108 are not the full story from common variation. So as I'd said before in the talk, I said that about a quarter of the susceptibility is to do with common variance, but the findings we have now only explain about 10% of that. So it could be that there's really 1,000 variants we need to know about before we have a fairly full list. So although we're starting to mine the data from the rare variants into the common variants, we just don't have the full accurate list yet. So it is a thing. It's the obvious thing for us to do, but it's just difficult to do that at the moment. Okay? Yeah.
One question that relates to how this genetic theory of schizophrenia fits in with the previous theory of the environment that influences, you know, clearly case in family where mother is schizophrenic, then child would also develop schizophrenia. And one could say, okay, this is a clear example of genetic transmission, or the fact that the environment can have, especially from the mother or the father, can have such a strong impact on the way that the brain can develop, can handle with stress. Do you think they're completely two different cases? Do you think that...
So, I think that I didn't really go into that in any detail, but certainly right through, I mean, we were talking about this over dinner last night, right through to this, from the end of this German era, if you like, the work of maybe Schneider, right through then to the sort of 60s and 70s, there was a whole social psychiatry movement and a view that it was all about parenting and the family environment. But from the 60s, people like Seymour Ketty and others did
very large twin and adoption studies. So they were able to demonstrate that the concordance in risk between monozygotic twins and dizygotic twins, even though they were born in the same environment, was substantially different. So if you were a dizygotic twin, your risk was 10%, whereas if you're a monozygotic, it was 50%, even though you're in the same environment. What was also done were adoption studies in two different directions. So the first was, people assumed that if you were reared in an environment with schizophrenia in the house, that that was going to increase your risk of schizophrenia. The reality is it actually doesn't. So there's been examples where people, and this has been studied systematically, where people have been adopted into a household where one of the parents ends up having schizophrenia. And your risk of schizophrenia does not increase. If you didn't have a biological risk when you were adopted into that house, your risk of schizophrenia doesn't increase. What's kind of interesting and sad, and sometimes I do some work for, occasionally advise an adoption agency at home about risk, and people have the view that if a child has a biological risk of schizophrenia but they don't and they rear the child properly, you know, with love and care and attention, that it's not going to affect, you know, that it is going to have a huge impact on the risk of developing schizophrenia, and that's not true. So essentially, if a child with schizophrenia is brought up by parents who don't have schizophrenia, the risk is the same. It's 8 or 9%. So I've advised families where two parents are affected, and we know that if both your parents are affected with schizophrenia, your risk of developing schizophrenia is 50%, irrespective of whether you're reared with your parents or elsewhere. So that's not to say that I just say it's all genetic, or I believe that obviously the brain and how brain development happens is a sort of it's a dialogue between us and our environments all the time. But from the studies that have been done so far, the evidence is that the home environment, so the shared environment from a sort of a twin point of view or from an adoption study point of view, has a relatively small effect on risk. The greater environment that we grow up in certainly does contribute to risk. So one thing that we're really not into yet is trying to do detailed studies to look at gene and environment risk together to see how that operates. So there is this... you know, the view persists actually that schizophrenia, you know, a lot of it is environmental, but actually the home environment is actually surprisingly uninfluential in that regard. Okay.
So also on the societal side of things, you mentioned the stigma. You know, I guess that all mental patients tend to be the victims of stigmatization, but schizophrenics in particular. And has that something to do with people's belief that schizophrenics are more violent than patients with other kinds of conditions? Or, and if so, is this thing with the violence, is it a fact? Or is it fiction or something that people imagine about these people?
So I think that people, if you ask somebody in the street about schizophrenia, they have a view of something very other, very different to them, very scary and difficult to understand. They also have this view of violence. And that's because, you know, high-profile instances where people with schizophrenia are violent are highly reported. But there is certainly a greater risk of violence and schizophrenia than there is just in the general population. But the risk is highly overestimated. So the risk of severe violence is less than 1% in the schizophrenia population. So people, you know, say to me, you're a psychiatrist, is that scary? And actually, you know, I go in every day, I'm kind of social, I end up meeting these people over many years, and I meet these people, they're really nice people that I get to know, and it never enters my head that there could be risk or violence. Now, it can happen, but, you know, if somebody is very unwell, so I'm dealing with a woman at the moment who's in her 50s, who's in hospital, who knocked me on my ass the last time I was in hospital. I told her I was detaining her under the Mental Health Act, and she knocked me over. You know, but that's the only violence I've personally experienced. And she was so apologetic afterwards. She still sort of to this day says, I'm really sorry, I wasn't well at the time. So, you know, generally, people with schizophrenia are like everybody else, unless, you know, when they're unwell, you know, there is unpredictability comes with that. And just, if I can just elaborate slightly on that, if it's okay. I was involved in a sort of a public anti-stigma campaign in Ireland last year, and we did some public lectures, and I obviously lectured in this area. And my colleagues who were talking about autism were able to line up high-profile people who were happy to talk about the fact that they had Asperger's syndrome. We were able to identify people with depression, sports figures, or other well-known figures in the community who were happy to come and talk about their experience of depression. We couldn't identify anyone publicly. You know, we would know of people who were who had experienced psychosis, but we couldn't approach or identify anybody who'd agree to come and stand up and talk about their experience, who was a role model in the community. So, you know, 10 years ago or 15 years ago when I started, it would have been very difficult to get people to stand up and talk about depression. Whereas that's changed here in Ireland, in the States, it's changed a lot. And people see positive role models, and I think it makes it easier for everybody. And we're not there yet in schizophrenia. There are role models. I would cite Ellen Sachs, who's a very interesting lady, who's a professor of law in, I think, UCLA, who has a history of schizophrenia herself and wrote a wonderful book about her own experience. And has given a really good TED talk. So if you wanted to YouTube TED talks, she's a great TED talk describing the experience. And she's a real public advocate. But there aren't very many role models that stand up and talk about it.
Hollywood took up the theme with A Beautiful Mind.
Yes.
That probably had an impact on public perception.
Yeah, I think that probably had a positive impact on public perception. I think there are movies that have been made that have a more public, you know, positive impact, but I think having somebody well known and famous who's really considered a role model, particularly for young people, to stand up and actually say, I've been through this experience, would make a big difference. They are out there, so there's a few, and there's a band I like called Passion Pit, who their lead singer has bipolar disorder and will stand up and talk about his experience of that, but you don't see people standing up and saying, you know, I have schizophrenia, and that's a challenge.
I think we should thank our speaker for a very interesting and stimulating talk. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.